is a spell and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace. When fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all. Here in the love of Christ, I stand.
Hey, Dame. Hey everybody, I don't know if you can hear the music or not because it's coming from my laptop that I'm streaming from. Thank you, Judy, or James, I'm assuming that's Judy. So I hope you could hear the music. It talks about our strength is in our Lord, in Jesus, and we need to be reminded of that. We know that in our head, but sometimes we forget. We don't live that way, so it's just a reminder. Standing in His strength and living in His strength each day. I hope you're doing well today. It's good to see your names pop up there on the side and of my monitor. And I just was reminded today that there are several who are watching that for some reason their names don't pop up here on the screen. So thank you so much for joining our Bible study on Wednesday nights. And I would encourage you to invite other people. Tell them to join us, and at least we can share some time together and some Bible study time. And you can see I'm not in my office at the church building. I'm at home tonight. So I hope everything comes across clearly. I've moved from where I was last time we tried this, and it was a little slow. So I'm closer to our router, and I think it'll work better tonight. So If it doesn't, let me know, okay? So I hope y'all are doing well tonight. I wanted to share some prayer requests with you. If you're following along, if you have a bulletin, I want you to add these names to those that you already have. If you're not part of the Homewood family, please write these names down tonight and lift these folks up in prayer. So I just received a phone call that Annette Causey is sick, and so she is fighting pneumonia, and ask you to lift Annette up in prayer tonight. She's very sick. Also, William Ray is also very sick. So pray for William, Annette and William both. And also, let's lift up Miss Hazel Dove. Miss Hazel had a fall a few days ago and has a concussion. So pray for Miss Hazel. Add her to your list. If you would, that would be wonderful. And I'm going to add my sister there back on the list. If you'd lift up Debbie in your prayers, it would be much appreciated. Also, Michael Holmes, fellow that's struggling, and family and friends are praying for him tonight. So let's add Michael Holmes to our prayer list so we can pray for him. Also, Amy Calhoun, a friend or a name that came from Miss Grace Granger. Let's add Amy Calhoun to our list, as well as Alma Skipper and Cindy Jones. Alma Skipper and Cindy Jones, and then Walter Gardner. Walter Gardner. Also, could we add Miss Helen Hardwick to our prayer list? Miss Helen and Angela Todd. Miss Angela's having some tests and having to go to down to Charleston or Mount Pleasant there. So lift Miss Angela up in your prayers. That would be much appreciated. Angela Todd. Also, John Poston. Charles Rhodes has been updating us on his cousin, John. And the last post I got yesterday, he's really struggling. Pray for John and his wife and the decisions that the doctors and caregivers have to make. So lift John up in prayer. Also, if you'll remember, Preacher Earl Spivey is going to have his surgery on the 11th of February, coming up in just 2 weeks, 11th of February. So let's be covering Pastor Spivey in prayer, Preacher Earl. And then Laura Haruska found out that she's going to have her surgery on the 26th of February. So lift Laura up, the 26th of February. Also, let's just continue as a reminder, continue to lift Barbara Bryant and family up in prayer, and Linda and Michelle Tyler and family up in prayer. So many times we forget, or we need to be reminded. So I appreciate it if you would do that. Can y'all hear me okay? I'm getting some responses there that they can't hear me. So if you can hear me, just say yes or let me know, okay? I don't want to be just talking to myself here. I hope y'all can hear me. Also, Jerry McVeigh and David, let us know how your dad's doing there. So we're going to continue to pray for Jerry. Also, the Wayne Hardwick family. Wayne Hardwick family. Thank you. Appreciate y'all letting me know. Wayne Hardwick family, I believe that funeral is this Saturday. What Sonia was saying just a moment ago. And his wife, Erlene, is in the hospital, and she needs continual prayer as well. The family's going through a lot there, so continue to lift these folks up. So those are the additions to our prayer list. And if there are more, let me know. If there are more that we need to add to the list, please let me know. I would appreciate that greatly, and that way we could continue to pray for these folks. I turned my phone off. Some of you are saying it's breaking up, so I hope that may help. So they only have one thing pulling from the internet right now, and I hope that gets better for you. I know it's aggravating if it continues to break up and give you problems. I hope it doesn't. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll share some things together from God's holy word tonight. Heavenly Father, thank you for a lovely day that you made. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. And thank you, Lord, for giving us today. I pray that you would draw us close to you, grow us in our walk of faith, help us to trust you more and more each day. And I pray that you would use us as vessels and lights in a dark world to spread the gospel. And Father, we ask you to be with those on our prayer list and those that we called out tonight to add to that list in a special way, in a way that only you can. It's not just about physical healings or physical wellness. It's about spiritual wellness and peace and hope and eternity. And I pray, Lord, that you would help these folks to have these things prioritized in their lives. And I pray that you would give them caregivers and family members and friends and maybe sometimes total strangers that can point them toward you and share the scripture. And I pray, Lord, that these folks would trust in you and put you first, no matter their health or physical condition, but they would trust you. And I pray that you'd use us to do that, strengthen others, encourage them, and point them in the right direction toward Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for this time tonight. And I pray that what we talk about and the things that are accomplished would bring you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Okay, folks, I appreciate you joining me. And every time I look up, there's more people. So it's good to see you. It's good to see your names pop up there. And thank you so much for joining me. I have something I wanted to share with you from a devotional. This is a Billy Graham devotional, which was written a few years back. But this is the devotion for today, January the 27th. And this is what it says. We Christians are not to be conformed to this world in the way we think. The world, by its advertisements, its conversation, and its philosophy, is engaged in a gigantic brainwashing. Time yourself the next time you read the Bible and pray. Compare it to the amount of time you spend watching television or surfing the internet. Is God getting his share of your time and attention? Is the world shaping your mind or Christ? The scripture is from Philippians 2:5, which says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Did you know that you're being brainwashed? Somebody is forming the way we think. And the devotion for today is a reality check to ask us who that is, where that source is that's teaching us, that's causing us to think. I made a statement one time, I kind of got some sideways looks, that babies are born with no language. Babies are born with no language. They don't learn, they don't come out automatically speaking English or Chinese or Japanese or Swahili or any other language. They come out with no language. They learn their language from those that spend the most time with them. Those that spend the most time with them. I want to stop for just a second and add one more person or one more family to the prayer list. One that we actually were talking about last night in our church leadership team meeting, and that's Julie Johnson. I see Miss Helen put her up here, Miss Julie Johnson, and her three little ones, triplets that were born prematurely just a little bit ago. So let's add her to the list, and I'll try to pay attention to if you put any other names up there before we leave. So I want you to think about what I just said about babies born with no language. They learn their language from whomever they're around. It's the same with you and me. We learn, we're influenced by those that are around us the most. And that's why in the devotion it says we're not to be conformed to this world in the way that we think. Whatever it is that is getting most of our attention, that's what we're learning. That's what we're becoming like. And the devotional was very convicting in saying the next time we have our devotion, the next time we pray and read the scripture and spend time with God, time it and see how much time we spend with God. And then time how much time we spend watching television or on the internet or going through social media and see who's getting most of our time. And that's really who's influencing us the most. I want to share something with you tonight from 1 Kings. 1 Kings, if you'll go back to the Old Testament, the 1 Kings, and go to chapter 19. This is one of my favorite passages. I just want to remind you what's going on here and share something with you there while you're turning. And I hope you have God's Word with you, because it's a lot easier to learn and to grow if you have God's Word in front of you. Okay, take some notes and read along. In 1 Kings chapter 19, there's a very familiar story, and it says Elijah flees from Jezebel. You remember this story? In chapter 18, Elijah's praying, and he prays to the Lord because all the worshipers of Baal or Baal were there, and they were comparing. And he said, "Our God is the real God." And Elijah said, "No, I serve the one true God." And there was this big showdown, and there was an altar, and Elijah told him to pour some water on the altar and pour some more water on the altar. And he prays, and the Lord sends down fire, and he consumes everything. And shortly after that, in chapter 19, after this great victory, and the Lord shows up, and he consumes the fire, and Elijah has seen a great victory. In verse 45 of chapter 18, it says, "So it came about in a little while that the sky grew black with clouds and wind, and there was a heavy shower, and Ahab rode and went to Jezreel. Then the hand of the Lord was on Elijah, and he girded up his loins, and out ran Ahab to Jezreel." There's a great victory, and God is with Elijah, and it talks about Ahab. And then in chapter 19, it says, "Now Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, 'So may the gods do to me and even more if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time.'" In other words, Jezebel said, "Your days are numbered. I'm coming after you." Now, I want you to understand something. This is not where the story starts. First of all, Ahab is married to Jezebel, okay? And Ahab has been defeated publicly by the Lord God through his servant Elijah. And he told his wife, Jezebel, about what Elijah did. And Jezebel sent a very poignant message to Elijah and said, "By tomorrow this time, you'll be dead, man. I'm coming after you." And Elijah runs. He flees and he hides, which is one of the most comical things in Scripture. You would think after such a victory in the Lord and after seeing God's hand come down and burn up all this, all the altar, what's on the altar and the sacrifice, that Elijah would be a man full of confidence in God. But not so. He's running from this king's wife who's very angry at him, and he's running for his life. I want you to back up to chapter 17. Chapter 17, so you'll understand a little bit more about why this comes to pass. This isn't the first time that Jezebel has seen Elijah do something in her husband's life that she didn't like. But we don't talk about this one as much. It doesn't get as much publicity or much reading study time as chapter 18. But in chapter 17, Elijah predicts a drought, and he does that because God told him what was going to happen. But look at chapter 17, 1 Kings chapter 17. "Now Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the settlers of Gilead, said to Ahab," same Ahab, he's king, okay, king of Israel. And at this time, Israel is divided into two kingdoms, the northern kingdom, Israel, and the southern kingdom, Judah. Ahab is king of the northern tribes at this point, and he's a wicked, wicked man. If you back up a few verses, you'll see that Ahab had done more wickedness and provoking God than any other person before him. Okay, so he's not a nice guy at all. And Elijah comes to him, and he says this to Ahab in verse 1, chapter 17, "As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, before whom I stand, surely there shall be neither dew nor rain these years except by my word." In other words, there's a famine coming, and it's not going to be changed until I say it's going to change. Verse 2, "And the word of the Lord came to him, saying, 'Go away from here and turn eastward, and hide yourself by the brook Cherith, which is east of the Jordan.'" And it shall be that you shall drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to provide for you there. So I want you to get the picture and follow the storyline. God says to Elijah, I want you to go to the king and tell him that I'm going to send a famine, and it's not going to rain on the land. So Elijah does that, and then God tells him, you need to leave here, and I'm going to put you beside this brook because that's where you're going to get your water. And I'm going to send the ravens to feed you. Why would he need to do that? Because the drought is going to affect him as well. I want you to get this picture, okay? Understand, Elijah is an obedient servant of God. He has told the king what God told him to tell him. And now God says, what you just said to him is going to affect you. The drought, the famine is going to affect you as well. And watch how this happens. In verse 5, so he went, Elijah went and did according to the word of the Lord, for he went and lived by the brook Cherith, which is east of the Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning, and bread and meat in the evening, and he would drink from the brook. Okay, so far, everything's going well. Now you think about this. This is God's servant. He's been obedient. He's done what God said. And he delivered this message to this king, a dangerous mission. And now he's living beside, he had to go away and go out to where God told him and live beside the brook because that's the only place that he could survive according to the Lord, because that's where he was going to get his water and his sustenance. God was going to send him food by the ravens. Okay? Now you think about what our faith level is, and we talk about having faith in God. What if God did the same thing to you and to me? What would we be doing during the day? Would we be looking for the ravens, or maybe trying to plant a garden or do something on our own just in case God forgot? Well, God never forgets, by the way. Verse 7, it says, and it happened after a while that the brook dried up because there was no rain in the land. Now think about this. Elijah told the king exactly what God told him to tell him. There's a drought coming. And as a result of that, there's going to be a famine in the land. And God told Elijah, you go over next to the brook, and I'm going to feed you by the birds, and you're going to drink the water there. So he's taken care of. A little nerve-wracking. God's taking care of him in a way that he probably wouldn't have chosen. And you and I were probably terrified because we're not being able to go to the store, and our jobs are a little iffy. And God says, I'll provide for you, but it's going to be in a different way. Maybe a little more meager means than what you would like. And then all of a sudden, in verse 7, it says, the brook dried up because there was no rain. Have you ever felt like that, God, I'm doing everything you say. I'm being obedient to you, and I'm following after you. And Lord, I've done this for you, and I've left this person, or I've moved our families. We've changed directions, and all this because you told us to. And now we're here, and the brook's drying up. God, are you still there? Have you ever been there in your life? And maybe, just maybe, you're kind of there now. I've talked to you several times in the last several weeks about God's economy, the way God does things. And I want you to see this passage tonight, this whole chapter of 17, because this is how God works. And as a follower of Christ, you can expect that God is consistent in how he works with his children. If you have gravitated towards something that's different than this economy, move away from it. If you have grabbed onto something that says, if I become a follower of Christ, hey, I'm going to live in a larger home, I drive a better car, I'm never going to have to wonder about my health, my job, my finances, everything's going to be the best it's ever been. Okay? I want you to understand something. That's not in God's Word. The biggest blessing that you and I receive as believers in Christ is having His presence in our lives. He blesses us with himself, his presence. I'll just move on a little bit, okay? Verse 8, then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and stay there. Behold, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. Now, I want you to understand this. God said, Elijah, go to the brook, and I'm going to send you some food by the ravens twice a day. You drink the water, you eat the food, and everything's good. Now the brook dries up, and God says, okay, let's go somewhere else. I want you to go over here to this town, and I'm going to send you to a widow to provide for you. Now, in our day and time, that might not mean a whole lot because we have several widows in our congregation and in our community, and that's a different thing than it was back then. Back then, a widow meant something a whole lot different, okay? And so he says, I am sending you to a widow there to provide for you. Now, I don't know about you. We don't have any details about what happened right here with Elijah. We don't have any idea that he talked back to God or said, wait a minute. But for most of us at this point in the junction, we would probably say, God, let's just sit down and discuss this a minute, okay? But watch what happens in verse 10. So he arose, okay? As far as we know, he did exactly what God said. He arose and went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, behold, a widow was there gathering sticks. Now watch what she's doing and why she's doing it. A widow was there gathering sticks, and he called to her and said, please get me a little water in a jar that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, please bring me a piece of bread in your hand. Now there's still a famine going on, okay? But she said, verse 12, but she said, as the Lord your God lives, there's a recognition of who Elijah was or who his God was. I have no bread, only a handful of flour in the bowl and a little oil in the jar. And behold, I am gathering a few sticks that I may go in and prepare for me and my son that we may eat it and die. Now, this widow, remember, God sent Elijah to this lady. And he said, this lady's going to provide for you. Elijah gets there, meets the lady, asks her for some water, and then some bread. And she says, listen, I'm out here just getting a little bit of the last of what we need because I only have enough for me and my son for one more meal. And then we're going to die because that's all we have. Now, folks, I don't know about you. I can't answer for you, but I can tell you something, that when God does this, you and I want to sit down and have a conference. And we say, now, God, no, wait a minute. I didn't sign up for this, okay? This doesn't fit into the health, wealth, and prosperity message at all. And you said that the widow was going to take care of me. Well, standing right in front of me is a widow who has already told me she doesn't have enough to feed her and her son. They're planning on dying of starvation because this is all they have. God, I think you messed up on this one. Now, we're smart enough not to say that, but sometimes we think it, don't we? Maybe in the last several weeks, we've thought it. God, I think you missed the point. Maybe you're out of the country because have you seen what's going on in our country here lately? Well, folks, let me tell you, God's not surprised by anything, and he's not anywhere else that he's not here as well. He's everywhere. He's omnipresent. Nothing shocks him. Nothing happens that he's not already aware that it's going to happen. So let's see what happens to God's servant. Okay? She says that we may eat and die. Verse 13. Then Elijah said to her, do not fear. Now I want you to understand something. He's in need of food as well. Okay? He's not speaking to somebody after he just sat down at a buffet. Okay? But look at his focus. And look at how he's directing his conversation. Then Elijah said to her, do not fear, go. Do as you have said, but make me a little bread cake from it first. In other words, you take a little bit of what was just enough for you and your son, and you give it to a total stranger because God said so. Now she's got to act out of faith or not here. He says, but first make me a little bread cake first, and bring it out to me, and afterward you may make one for yourself and for your son. Now watch verse 14. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, The bowl of flour shall not be exhausted, nor shall the jar of oil be empty until the day that the Lord sends rain on the face of the earth. Now, at some point in this journey, God had given Elijah this word. He had told Elijah what he was going to do in the life of the widow. I want you to put things in order here like a simple math equation. God said, Elijah, I want you to go to this widow because where you are has run out of resources. And the widow will provide for you. Yet when Elijah gets there, the widow has nothing to offer to him. But God has told Elijah somewhere in this journey that he was going to provide for that widow. Okay? There's a lot of trust and faith in this equation that's required for all this to come together. So in verse 15 it says, so she went and did according to the word of Elijah. And she and he and her household ate for many days. And I want you to understand the order. Elijah told her it was the word of God. And she did according to the word of Elijah. The word of God came through his servant. Elijah spoke and gave authority by pointing to Jesus, by pointing to the Lord. And she did as she was told. Verse 16, the bowl of flour was not exhausted, nor did the jar of oil become empty, nor did the jar of oil become empty according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke through Elijah. Now, if we stopped right there, it's a magnificent story of faith and trust, not just from the widow, but from Elijah. And sometimes we see those two categories as polar opposites, the haves and the have-nots. And according to the way we're taught a lot of times, we see ourselves, the people of Christ, as the haves. In other words, our lives are supposed to be at a different level here on this planet. We're supposed to have more. We're supposed to be a certain, be healthier, wealthier, wiser, and all these things. And the have-nots are those people who have yet to follow after Christ. Folks, I want you to see this, that this economy, this description of God's servant, Elijah, and how he provides for Elijah, and how he provides for the widow, is how he still provides for his servant and those that those servants are supposed to go to. It requires faith and trust. And you and I are not going to get a list of how everything's going to come together. God never does that. He doesn't say, step out of the boat. Before you step out of the boat, I'm going to build you a bridge here that you can walk on. He never does that. When he tells Elijah to tell Ahab there's a drought, it's not going to rain, there's a famine coming, he didn't say, Elijah, before you deliver this message, you might want to go down to the grocery store and stock up, okay? You're going to need it. Mm-mm. Not only does he not do that, but the message that he gives to Ahab, and by the way, he did this because Ahab was such a wicked king, okay? Such a wicked man, and he needed to learn. He was being disciplined. So was Israel, okay? That's how all this came about and why it all came about. Elijah wasn't spared the results of that discipline. He was right in the middle of it. He was going to starve unless the Lord provided for him as well. And God said, sit by the brook and I'll send you food with the ravens. And he did that until the brook dried up. And he says, okay, let's go somewhere else. And now I'm going to provide a widow who's going to provide for you. Do you feel like God changes his ideas sometimes and he gives us provision a certain way, and then that dries up? You feel like that sometimes, even today? Lord, you've been providing for me this way for years, and all of a sudden, it stopped. Now what? Now what is God that's provided for you and for me through that avenue, whatever that is in your life, is the same God who's going to provide for you and me through a different avenue? Well, I can't see it. You don't have to see it. Neither do I. Elijah couldn't see it. He wasn't even in the same vicinity as the widow. God said, get up and move and go to where I'm going to provide for you. And folks, that's what we have to do as believers in Christ. Christians, followers of Christ here in the 21st century in the United States of America or wherever we find ourselves, is we have to first acknowledge that everything we need comes from Jesus Christ. And He is everywhere. He's omnipresent. Okay? He's all-knowing. He's omniscient. And He's all-powerful, omnipotent. Okay? And that whether He's providing for us through our jobs and our health, or whether we find ourselves in the hospital and He's providing for us through the caregivers and family and friends, doesn't matter. Our provision comes from the same source. God is always our source, not our health, our jobs, our bank account, our church, our family, our friends, none of that. Remember the supply lines we talked about months ago? Okay. God is the source. He uses different supply lines. But He's our source. So if the story stopped right here, then we would say this is a great ending. The widow and her son have food all the time. It's not going to run out. They've been able to take care of Elijah. He's living with them, and they're taken care of. Okay? But it doesn't stop here. Look at verse 17. Verse 17, now it came about after these things that the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, became sick, and his sickness was so severe that there was no breath left in him. So she said to Elijah, what do I have to do with you, O man of God? You have come to me to bring my sin, my iniquity to remembrance, and to put my son to death. And she said, what in the world? Why did you have to come here? And now, surely it's my sins that have caused my son to be sick to the point of death. In verse 19, Elijah says, and he said to her, give me your son. And then he took him from her bosom and carried him up to the upper room where he was living and laid him on his bed. And he called to the Lord and said, O Lord my God, hast thou also brought calamity to the widow with whom I am staying, by causing her son to die? And that's an honest question. And folks, you would think Elijah, somebody like Elijah or Abraham or Moses, they didn't have to ask questions. They knew everything. No, they didn't. They had to walk by faith just like you and I do. They walk by faith and trust in the Lord God. And he says, Lord, have you brought calamity on this family that's taking care of me? And verse 21 says, then he stretched himself upon the child three times and called to the Lord and said, O Lord my God, I pray thee, let this child's life return to him. I want you to notice how many times in this passage, in this chapter, Elijah calls on the Lord. How often are we calling on the Lord these days? I don't mean going to Facebook or picking up the phone or going to visit somebody and just talking about all the problems and what are we going to do and when's this going to happen and when's this vote taking place, and we just fret and we're anxious and stressed out. But I want you to notice that the servant of God, Elijah, continues to call on the name of the Lord. And folks, you and I have a precious gift in prayer. And we go to the Lord and we call out His name. We say, God, I don't understand. I don't understand. However, I trust that You're in control. You're my source. And You're not surprised by anything that's going on. You know exactly what's happening. So Elijah calls on the Lord. He prays. And he says, let this child's life return to him. Verse 22. And the Lord heard the voice of Elijah. I love those passages that says that. You can read it in other places where God's children called on Him in repentance, and He heard their voice. He hears our voice when we call on Him earnestly, trusting Him with faith and bowing before His throne. Jonah did that. After 3 days in the belly of the fish, he calls out, and the passage says the Lord heard his cry. Verse 22, and the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the life of the child returned to him. Returned to him. He was dead, okay? Returned to him, and he revived. He wasn't just sick, okay? Verse 23, and Elijah took the child and brought him down from the upper room into the house and gave him to his mother. And Elijah said, see, your son is alive. Now watch at the result of all of this. Okay, verse 24. Then the woman said to Elijah, Now I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is true. That's why all of this took place in the way that it did. The end result was that the widow believed, not just in Elijah. It didn't stop there. Now I know that you are a man of God. Yes, she said that, but it didn't stop there. It says, and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is true. I believe in the word of the Lord that came from you. Why? She saw the faith that Elijah demonstrated. She saw that he cried out to God and he trusted God, and he knew that his sufficiency was in the Lord, not in his own abilities, not in his position as a prophet. None of that, that Elijah depended on God. Do you know how that's possible, folks? Because Elijah was dependent on God's supplying his every need, just like the widow was. Well, that's not a factor if we're not in the same situation as the people we're preaching to, we're talking to. The message of the gospel means so much more when people see that we too have to walk by faith and trust God, and we too have to ask for forgiveness and trust in the work of Calvary. I'll give you an illustration of this. We watched a part of a movie here recently that came out years ago. It's called Guardian, and it's about Coast Guard rescue swimmers. And there were several well-known actors or actresses in the movie, but the two main actors were Kevin Costner and Ashton Kutcher. And it was about a seasoned Coast Guard rescue swimmer who was ended up mentoring an up-and-coming, very proud and troubled young man. And there was one scene in particular in the movie to where Kevin Costner, who was the veteran rescue swimmer who had gone through some very deep trials and valleys of his own recently and was trying to reassess and to figure life out because he had really gone through some struggles. He was teaching these new recruits, these new men and women who wanted to become rescue swimmers. And this school was used to lecturing and being in the classroom and showing videos and teaching the students that way. But Kevin Costner's character wanted them to really learn what it's like to be in the real situations. So one scene is they came to the barracks where these students were supposed to be to have a drill, and they weren't there. And they walk through and they find in one building, here's all the students in this small swimming pool that Kevin Costner has dumped a bunch of ice in, and it's freezing and they're all shivering cold. And he's teaching them about hypothermia. And he is not sitting outside the swimming pool giving them instruction. He is in the pool freezing himself. And his teeth are chattering. And he's trying to teach them about hypothermia and what happens to your body. And the teacher and the commander of the school there came in and said, "Can I have a word with you?" And he crawls out of the pool and he's shivering and he's can't hardly talk because he's so cold. And they said, "This is not the way we usually do this." And he said, "I'm teaching them about hypothermia." And he looked at his watch and he said, "In a short time," and I think he said like in 2.5 minutes or 1.5 minutes, "they'll get it. They'll understand it. May I have permission to get back to my class?" And they said yes, or the commander said yes. And he crawls back in the pool of ice. And he's shivering with the rest of them. But because he's in the pool with them, they listen to what he says. His words have weight and value. That if he was sitting outside the pool drinking some coffee and warm and toasty, they wouldn't respect what he was saying nearly as much. And folks, this is what I want you to get from this tonight in this passage in 1 Kings about Elijah. Elijah had to get in the pool. He had to be part of the famine, part of the drought for his words to carry weight and value to those that he was preaching to. You and I have been commanded and commissioned to take the Word of God to a lost world, to make disciples. We are to be in the world, but not of the world. And I'm afraid that a lot of us don't want to be in it. And when the world comes in around us and we are affected by the drought and the sin and the things that go on in this world, we're praying hard as we can, God, get us out of here. And God says, you stay in that pool with those people that are learning so they will hear what you're saying and you'll have more weight in your words and they'll believe you. And the widow believed the words of God coming from Elijah because she saw him have to live by faith. She saw a man come to her who had to have food to survive, and he had to trust God to provide for him. He wasn't just preaching the message, he was living the message. You see the difference? And folks, so many times, especially today, we are praying for God to get us out of here. Rescue us from this storm, God. I don't want to be here. And I think with all my heart, God says, if you just read my word, you'll find that you have to be in the midst of the storm to minister to those who are going through it. I can't rescue you. I can't rescue you if you truly want to reach out to those who are drowning and those who are perishing. You have to go through the storm too. So I hope you understand the story and the storyline of 1 Kings 17. And folks, I have to tell you that this is the gospel and this is God's economy. All through Scripture, you're going to find this. If you're serious about serving God, He's going to put you in the fire. He's going to put you in the lion's den. He's going to call you out of the boat into the stormy seas. If you're searching after some other message than what God's Word says, if you came to God because you're looking for a cushy life or some kind of my best life now mentality or theology, you've missed it. And you will not hear that from me. And I hope you understand that there is not a better place to be in the universe than in the will of our Lord. And you're not going to find that trying to escape the fire and the storm and the valleys and the famine and the drought. If you want to get close to God, if you want to walk closely to Him, with Him, He's going to lead you directly into the fire, the famine, the storm, the drought, the dead of night. But folks, it's there, just as the Hebrew boys in the midst of the fire experienced the presence of God. As the king looks in and says, I thought we threw three in there. I see four. And one of them looks like the Son of God. Embrace the trials. Expect them. Don't fight against them. Thank the Lord for growing us, maturing us, and teaching us to trust Him. Let me pray with you. Heavenly Father, your word says we have to die to self. Teach us to do that, Lord. Help us to die to self, not to rely on anything that this world has to offer, but to rely on you. And Father, help us to embrace that which you bring us through. The valleys, the storms, the darkness, the famines, the drought. Lord, help us not to kick and scream and pray to get out of the circumstance. But Lord, just like Elijah, turn his focus on the widow for her to follow after you and to be obedient to you. May we be so concerned about getting out the word of God that we forget about the condition we find ourselves in. Father, I thank you that we're not dependent on our health and our finances, even our family and our friends. We depend on you. You're alive and well. You love us beyond our understanding. Lord, thank you for your word and your spirit. Thank you for your economy, the way you do things. Help us to be obedient, yielding and surrendered, Lord, to your will and your way. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, folks. I love you. And I'll see you soon. Sunday morning, Lord willing, at 10:30. Have a great night.